must be lovers, we'll marry our fortunes together. I've got some real estate here in my bag.
This is gonna be lesson number 7. Before, in the last lesson, we went over something called supply and demand, and how... we went over supply and demand, and how that's going to help us determine our price through what's known as equilibrium, where the supply and demand lines meet. Now, I told you guys about supply and demand, but I didn't tell you guys how to make those supply and demand. So that's what I'm going to be going over in today's lesson, which is actually going to be a multi-part lesson because it's actually the most complicated thing to do in like the entire like FEMO kind of lessons. So buckle in, I guess.
Aha!
So the first thing we're going to talk about is elasticity. And the way why we're talking about this is because it deals with slope. But it's not in the slope that you think it is. If you guys just look over here, what you guys know as, so there's quantity and there's price. Can anyone tell me what the slope of this line is? Yes, Paul? 0. So the slope may be 0. But in elasticity, we actually do the inverse. So what you see here is like, I don't know, like 0/2 or something like that, which gives you 0. But in elasticity, we would see 2/0. Which would give us infinity. So the thing is that when we go over elasticity, remember when it comes down to slope, you'll be doing the inverse of it. It's just a little side note. So to understand elasticity, you have to understand that not all the supply and demand lines have the same slope. It can be anywhere from, I can't remember the board a little. It can be anywhere from like this to like this. They're not the same slope, obviously. Some are flatter, some are more steeper. So what we're gonna go over in elasticity is the first step in which we figure out what is that slope. And I think that's probably the most important part. So the steeper the slope is, the less price changes affect you. So let's say here, well, I'll go back to the board here, because that's much easier. And also, is it off a little bit? So if we look on the board right over here, this is sort of steep. I'll draw two lines. One like this, and one that's like this. So if we start over here at this point, and let's say there's a hypothetical price. So our price starts here, P1. Let's say we have a price 2 right here. This is our quantity right now, Q1, the first quantity. And let's say we move to P2 on both lines. So we have one point here, and one point here. So, if you see here, when it came down to the two lines, the one for the steeper line, the quantity didn't move as much as with the flatter line. So that's what I'm talking about with elasticity. The steeper the slope, the less price change affects your quantity. So why are some curves steeper? You probably raise that. Why are some curves steeper than others? So to understand steepness, we have to, let's start with an extreme example. Just a quick note, we're actually going over demand right now. So let's start with an extreme example of a monopoly on water. A monopoly meaning that there's only one company in control of this, and water being is an absolute necessity. So what goes on is that even if we change the price, humans still need it. No matter what the price is. Unless, of course, people can't afford it, so yeah, that would happen.
Wait, are you saying that need disappears when humans just don't need water? Is that what you just said?
No, I mean like, if the price is too much that they can't afford it, they won't get it. So...
so they'll just die?
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, I didn't want to like say that.
No, be as morose as possible, Devin.
Oh yes, so that's what I was implying, that they would die.
Oh, okay. But yeah, just to make that clear.
So even if the price changes, the demand will stay exactly the same. So if you see here, this line is straight up. No matter the price, if I'm here or I'm, if I'm over here with this price, a higher price or a lower price, exactly the same demand. Unless, of course, people die, but I don't want to get into that kind of stuff if it's like too extreme of a price. And this is known, if you see right here, as perfect inelasticity. Now, can anyone tell me the slope, like what you guys would normally see as the slope of that line? So I'll just put it up here, much easier. It looks like that, straight vertical line. Could anyone tell me, besides Paul? Oh, yeah.
Undefined,
yeah. Or something like infinity, something like that. That's what you guys would call it. But if you look here, I said there was a coefficient of zero. So what that means is that the elasticity was zero. Because remember that elasticity and slope are inverses of each other. We don't do y divided by x, price divided by demand, by quantity, but instead we do quantity divided by price. So this would be your slope, but this would be elasticity. Now it's really easy to convert from elasticity to slope. Just do one divided by that elasticity and you switch. So that's why I'm able to talk about elasticity today. So this is known as perfect inelasticity. And what that means is that there's absolutely no substitutes to water. I don't know what you guys can find to substitute for water. You can say juice, but juice is made out of water, so. There's no substitute. And what that means is that people have to buy it. And in this case, there was no competition either. So people have to buy your product. So what happens is that it's known as perfect inelasticity, in which the price does not affect it at all. So that's an extreme example. Yes, Theodore?
But aren't monopolies illegal?
Yes, they are. Unless you're talking about like Google, where they're close to a monopoly, but they're not called it. But yeah, that's a different story.
Devin has a strong bias against Google.
Yeah, I do. I have a very strong bias against Google.
That's why he uses Bing.
So, now we're going to talk about the other extreme. Something that has a lot of substitutes. A thing that I can replace easily. If a product has many substitutes, and there's a change in the price, people can easily switch to those substitutes. Just a quick note, substitute doesn't have to come in the form of products, such as like natural gas being oil substitutes, but also can come in the form of companies like Samsung and Apple, like competing stuff. Just think of that as substitutes. And if something has a lot of substitutes, then we're going to be known as elastic, what you had seen as the flatter kind of line. So not like a, inelastic would be more steeper, but what elastic is, or elastic, I'm not really good at pronouncing stuff, it's much more flatter, like this. And that means this much flatter. So a change in price would mean a bigger change in quantity, which means that price affects it more. So yeah, that's what I did here. And it says responsive demand. There'll be a small change in price, like from here to here, called a large change in quantity demanded. So you see there's like the price changed a little, but the quantity changed much more. That's known as elastic. Now the opposite was inelastic, which we have covered, in which it's much steeper. So now, we're gonna just go over some of the points to make sure before we give like a problem. So a monopoly has a very steep demand line, meaning that it's inelastic. Its price changes doesn't affect it. That means they can raise prices and it wouldn't change it as much as it would if it was not a monopoly and had many substitutes. A company with many substitutes has a very flat demand line, meaning it's elastic. Price changes affects it greatly. Now this stuff would come in later if you guys are making decisions. But first, when we were talking about the price, it will be used for that spring. So the more substitutes a product has, the flatter the demand line will be. And that's probably the most important part. The more substitutes, the more flatter. Or the more competition, the more things that I can replace it with, the more flatter the demand line will be. The demand line meaning the negative correlation one. So the one that has a negative slope. So, We're gonna be talking about, what is the elasticity of iPhones? So, like, what would be the slope of this iPhone? So, can anyone tell me how many substitutes, like products or companies, does the iPhone have? Nina, you wanna tell me? Like, name one or a couple.
Samsung.
Yeah, of course, there's Samsung. Anything else? Are there any others? Any products can I replace a phone, an iPhone with? There's like a flip phone. Yes.
Either. Messenger pigeon.
You're right. That's more uncommon these days, but I would still put it.
Crafts in the Mongolian market, yeah.
Yes, yes. Anything else? Yes, Paul?
Nokia.
The Nokia, yeah. I'll just put Nokia phone. Gia, you want to give me an example of something you could replace an iPhone with?
Samsung.
Oh, we said that.
Nokia.
We said that already.
Cricket Mobile is wireless.
That's what
she's saying.
You know any companies or stuff?
She said Google.
Yeah, like the Pixel. So there tends to be, like, nowadays, with like all these introductions of like new phones and all that kind of stuff, there tends to be more substitutes to this kind of thing. So because there's more substitutes, do you think that will be elastic, or do you think it will be inelastic? So going back to the last slide, the more substitutes the product has, the flatter or the more elastic it will be. Do you think it will be elastic or inelastic? Rahul, what do you think?
Elastic.
You'll be elastic, why?
Because if you change your price and pick it up, like, rather than be easy, just change it.
Yes, yeah, that's exactly right. Except, it's more inelastic than not. Why is that? It's because they created a monopoly. I'll just deem it creating a monopoly through rent. It's not an actual monopoly. There's obviously competitors out there. But if you think about it, have you ever seen those hardcore Apple fans out there? They're only for Apple, like absolutely only for Apple. You can't offer them like Samsung or anything. So although there may be many substitutes, that does not necessarily will be an elastic curve. Of course, if they raise it dramatically, then of course they're, I'm pretty sure hardcore Apple fans will probably switch. So you probably see, instead of a line, you see more like this, more of a curve. Because like the more heavier the prices, it'll start dropping off, but not that badly because there's so many people. So a company can actually make a monopoly by using these branding skills. Like it's called a MOAB. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of that.
A MOAB. A mother of all mom.
No, a MOAB. M O A.
A
moat? I don't know if you guys can see
a
that.
A moat?
At this point, I'm bad at English. I'm just going to say it like a moat. So what happened is that's usually like that. If you ever seen like those castles and they always had like that bridge and that water area, that's exactly it. The moat.
Yes.
Yes. The moat. That's what the moat is.
Just general English. That's a moat.
Yes. General English. Yes. So the wider that moat is, the more likely that people can enter the market. And monopolies have this huge moat. So if you have a bigger moat, like Apple does, you'll be more inelastic. There'll be less competition, less substitutes for your target audience. So let's take Pepsi, for example. There may be 100, like many, many different brands of soda, yet many people still go to the stores specifically for Pepsi. Just for Pepsi. They don't want Coca-Cola, they want Pepsi. That means they can raise prices by a dollar, and still most people will prefer to buy Pepsi since they prefer the brand. So people can usually just, in their minds, be focused on a specific brand and forget all the other substitutes. And in their mind, it would, well, in general, it would make the company's demand line more inelastic. Although, you may be like, oh, there's many substitutes, because of those specific people, you may be getting more inelastic. It wouldn't make it completely inelastic, but it would make it more inelastic. And so that's gonna conclude our demand line so far with the theories. of making the demand lines slope. We're gonna be getting into supply and then actually creating the slope and like examples of slope in the following lessons of this, following parts of this lesson. So that's all for now. Yeah.
All right, good job, Devin.
Though I knew she was sleeping, I'm empty and aching, and I don't know why. Counting the cars on the New Jersey Turnpike, they've all come to look for us.